This is a Choppin It Up show brought to you by the Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio. And now, here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Good evening, and I thank God for my unconquerable soul. Welcome to the Choppin' It Up show. I am your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you tonight. Today is November 19th, 2013, 6 o'clock on the West Coast and 9 o'clock on the East Coast. We appreciate all those listening live and or listening in podcast form, whether through iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, or our website. At the end of this broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network, if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. All right, well, we are getting to the close of the end of the year, and we are approaching the holiday season. And to me, that's always the best type or the best time of year. You know, I'm really excited about our 90 Degree show that I would like you guys to check out on Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern. You can actually go to our website and vote on our Week 12 matchup winner. It is the SEAC Championship and one of my favorite battles, Albany State versus Miles College. Vote on who you think won the battle, whether on the field or in the stands or both. Vote on our website, themarchingpodcast.com, and I'll read the results on the 90 Degree Show this Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern. But tonight, we are chopping it up with Jason Elkins. Now, Jason is a really good dude. I met Jason back in 2004 in Nashville, Tennessee. Technically, I met him in Franklin, Tennessee, for all the folks that are familiar with that area. He was working at a temp agency, and his job was to, you know, find folks to fill positions. He worked in a building with the company that I eventually worked for, Smart Data Strategies, and they are a business partner of my current company now, ESRI. Long story short, I got the job and fulfilled the contract for Jason's company, and we've kept in touch over the years. I always give him credit for finding me my first job and starting my career. My first job out of school turned out to be this temporary position, and then I was living in Charlotte, and then I moved to Nashville because I saw more GIS jobs and opportunities, i.e., we just chopped it up with Dr. Padgett not too long ago back in Nashville. So, you know, I just saw more GIS opportunities there. So I moved to Nashville and was substitute teaching, working at a gas station. I was delivering pizzas all at the same time. And finally, I met Jason after about 9 months of all that, and he got me my job. One thing I remember about Jason, which ties into what he's doing now, is that he wanted to be friends, like, or, you know, he wanted to get to know the person well before he put them anywhere or before he put them in any job, you know. Now, I know that that sounds obvious for the position I told you, but it takes someone who really cares about the people that they're dealing with that make a difference. So Jason could have placed resumes and put a lot of people in a lot of jobs, and just by averages and sheer numbers, he would have made his money. But I think he wanted to have, you know, a 100% batting average. He didn't want to put someone somewhere and they didn't want to succeed, you know. So he's a really good dude. I remember another thing about him is that he always would take me to lunch, man. And I was like, yes. I was like, Jason, we going to lunch? And he'd be like, yeah, man, you know, let's go to lunch. And it was great. And I assumed that it was on the company as part of, like, the investment, you know, was one of the people working for them doing well at the company. But, man, Jason and I would eat good, man, and I really appreciate that. You know, we had a lot of good conversations at lunch and stuff, so it was cool. And then I was given the offer out here in California. He was the first person I told about it, you know, and, you know, he's like, make sure it's the right decision, you know, go through your checklist. It turned out to be. But again, Facebook, you know, saves the day. I find him after so many years and reconnected with him, and it was the perfect timing because he's doing his own thing for himself now. So tonight we're going to meet Jason and find out about all of that. This will be a podcast, but we'll accept your calls at 718-664-6025. You can email the show at martianpodcast@gmail.com. Tweet us at Martian Podcast. And you can follow our blog, blog4.themartianpodcast.com. If you're listening live and you have a Blog Talk Radio account, you can attend or open up the chat room. I'm doing that right now. That should be ready in a couple minutes or a couple seconds here. And if you have that Blog Talk Radio account, you can log in and enter comments. Or, you know, say hello or just, you know, listen. Oh, yeah, Jason was a blah, blah, blah. You can do that as well. So that chat room is now open as we speak. So if you're listening live again, and go ahead and scroll down and be a part of our chat. Last and definitely not least, check out our website, themartianpodcast.com. Let's take the time to hear from our sponsors. Tonight's show is brought to you by Liquid Effects Photography, Block Band Music, Bandhead.org, and HBCUnews.net. Let's take the time to hear from them now.
This is Curtis from 80MinutesOfRegulation.com. From referees whistle to drum majors whistling back, your source for sports and marching and athletic music. You're listening to Choppin' It Up on the Marching Podcast Network.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. And coming this fall, HBCUBands.com. Write that down, HBCUBands.com. Block Band is a minority-owned music business that you can think of as your assistant band director. We help grow your musicians with a great selection of traditional concert band music. Then we back up their performance with necessities like reeds, oil, drum heads, drumsticks, and mallets. Finally, we outfit your players in auxiliary and shoes, spats, and gloves that match our precise custom drills. Got band? If so, then Block Band's got you. Check blockbandmusic.com or call us at 919-698-2560. That's blockbandmusic.com, 919-698-2560. Do you know where to find scholarship information and other financial resources that are available to HBCU students? Are you up to date on the latest information in the HBCU world? If you answer no to any of these questions, then HBCU News with the Reads is the place for you. We provide information to spark interest, success stories of graduates, and the latest on issues that you care about. So check out HBCU News with the Reads, Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern on blogtalkradio.com/marching podcast. Check out our website and point your browser toward HBCUnews.net and join in on the calls and discussion today. Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity. Come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
Hey, this is Melita Wilson, founder of HBCU Campus Tours, alumni of Bethune-Cookman University. We're chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we're back, and we're ready to chop it up with Jason here, and we're getting all our information together. This will be a podcast, but we will accept your calls at 718-664-6025. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at Marching Podcast, and follow our blog, blog4.themartianpodcast.com. And like I said, if you're listening live, you can join our chat room. So we'll take enough time, and we're ready to chop it up with Jason. And without further ado, Jason Elkins. You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and we have a good friend here, Jason Elkins. What's going on today, Jason?
What's going on, Joe? It's good to talk to you.
Yeah, man, likewise. Good to hear from you. I met Jason back in 2004. I was looking for work, and Jason actually was the first person actually found me my first job. So always grateful to him, and just always wanted to keep in contact with you, man. So, and then I wanted to focus on what you're doing because, you know, you're always helping people, and that's kind of the theme of the whole network. So let's get right into it. Jason, where are you from?
I'm from Michigan. Grew up in northern Michigan, not in the Upper Peninsula part, but about an hour south of there. And went to Central Michigan University and got a degree in communication and advertising. And lived in Grand Rapids, so that's West Michigan. For most of my adult life until moving to Tennessee in 2003.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So when you say what was your major in school?
It was communication.
Okay.
Organizational communication, and I had a minor in advertising.
Okay, so did you have like dreams or aspirations of working in advertising or doing something in that field?
You know, it's funny, a lot of the work I do now is social media, which is as close to advertising as you can get right now. But I wanted to be a DJ. I wanted to do more of what you're doing right now on the podcast, actually.
Okay.
That was why I went to Central. They had a pretty good communications program there, and realized really quickly that without having people around me, that communicating and talking was something that I really didn't enjoy that much. I DJed parties and weddings and dances, and I did a lot of that through high school and even through college. And I really get my energy by being around other people.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of pulled up behind a microphone wasn't really, ended up not being a passion, which I thought it would be. I had to change directions pretty quickly when I got there, and advertising, from what I found out, was the easiest minor that you could get, so I think that's the one I snagged.
Okay. Well, that's great. Well, it's interesting that, you know, you said, you know, you had that passion, but then you actually, you know, you went through the experiences and you were able to say, well, yeah, I guess this is not me. So you said that after you finished, so when did you finish undergrad, if you don't mind me asking?
No, I graduated in 94. And, you know, before cell phones and the internet, and I got a job actually doing sales for a company that placed engineers into jobs, and really enjoyed kind of the hustle and the recruiting and placing aspect. And really, at the end of the day, I could lay my head down knowing I helped somebody.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, you mentioned that earlier. I really, that's what kind of fires me up. So, and man, I still remember that interview. You want to talk about that?
The interview with
your interview?
Oh yeah. Well, yeah. I was going to roll into that.
Okay.
But oh yeah, definitely. I mean, we could talk about it. I finished graduate school in 2003, and then moved to Nashville. I think like that following year in 2004. And just looking for a job, and you found my resume, and I met you, and it was really exciting because I had three jobs at the time. I worked at the BP, and actually worked at the cafe in the BP. It was the Wild Bean Cafe, and they had
wow.
They had like bagels and like coffees and stuff, and I worked at the Tennessean. I had a paper route.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah, and I worked at Papa John's. I delivered pizzas at night.
Oh, man, that's right.
Yeah.
I forgot about that.
So when you found me, it was great because, you know, I was ready to work in my field. I did that for like 9 months or something like that. And I kind of got used to it for a little while, you know.
Sure.
But, yeah, interview. And then you, I interviewed with Dave Barnwell.
Right.
And and is that the interview you were talking about specifically?
Yeah, I was blessed to actually be in that interview with you. And I don't know if we ever talked about this. We probably did, but the question that Dave asked, you know, you had mentioned something like your attention to detail was pretty high. And Dave had asked you, you know, tell me more about that or give me an example of that. And you said, well, when I was playing football, and I'm like, oh no, here we go. You know, this guy's about to blow it. And you said the knuckles posing line, if they're white, they're leaning forward, and it's going to be a rush. Do you remember that?
Yeah, oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, I still, because that was, like, one of the things that I picked up when I played football. I played for the Nashville Mustangs, a semi-pro
right.
team there, and I had picked up a little weight by that time in my life. So I was playing on the defensive line. And that was one of the things that, you know, that we had to, you know, pay attention to because, you know, one thing we learned about football, the guys were so big and fast and they were able to, you know, develop plays in like 2 to 3 seconds. You know, it was just really a gift out there. And a lot of times it was just looking like mass confusion when you were out there. So you had to have these intellectual tips and you had to have some type of way to know what you were going to do. Cause I mean, you basically had like 2 seconds to kind of decide sometimes.
Right.
And, looking at linemen, I mean, I was picking up weight, but still I'm kind of still skinny at heart, as they all say. So I was dealing with some big dudes, you know, and that was one of the things that I had to use was, you know, the quickness of when the ball was snapped to get around them. And if they were leaning forward, I could see the blood rushing in their hands, you know, because they were ready to, like, knock my block off, you know, as soon as the ball was
right.
tight. And if
right.
not, you know, they were going to be backing up to try to catch me as quick as possible off the snap, you know, as soon as I was going for the quarterback. So that was something that I had to use because it was mostly – he said, you know, attention to detail, it was something I had to use because I was not – the most athletically gifted out there. Even at the semi-pro level, there were some really, really gifted guys out there, you know.
Sure.
So I had to do as much as possible. So I remember you always remind me of that, and I always remember that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you walked out of that interview, and Dave and I were still there, and he looked at me, and he's like, I want this guy. And that was an interesting thing because he referenced that statement. Like, you know, if he pays attention that closely – to the world around him, this is a guy that's going to help us. We need somebody like that.
Yeah, it was
and
great.
I, you know, I'll never forget that. It was that was one of the fun interviews that I was able to be a part of. And it's cool to see. It's really great to see how much, you know, where this has taken you from that one moment. You know, delivering pizzas and working, you know, two other jobs to leading teams and whatnot, which you're doing now. It's just fantastic. You can awesome to see that.
Yeah, well, I appreciate it, and I've always been grateful to you because, you know, you were the one that gave me my shot. You know, I was my first interview. That was me, my real first job interview, and, you know, I was able to do it. But we were able to I think that what you were able to do is that I was just able to be more comfortable in there. And I think that's
sure.
how that discussion about football came out because, you know, I was just comfortable talking about sports to other males, especially I've noticed that now in the workforce, like sports is the easiest way to connect with someone, especially other guys.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It's not definitely not politics or religion or anything like that, you know.
So. Yeah, that's pretty – you can be pretty safe with sports, right?
Yeah. Exactly. So,
yeah. So
you know, you and I were able to talk, and you were like, "Hey, you know," and you basically you gave me the scenario pretty well. You know, you gave me the environment that I was going to be in, and who was watching, and you know why I was important. And I've even seen, you know, over the years, other staffing people and other staffing organizations, and the detail how you were able to, you know, take me out to lunch those times and meet with me to make sure that that I was the person that you needed. A lot of companies really don't do that. It's kind of like a glossing over, like, okay, we're giving the standard test, and if they pass, you know, we're just trying to make a paycheck, so to speak. And I thought what you did, you were really trying to get to know the people that you were working with and then place them. So I think that was the difference in what happened.
Yes, that's. I appreciate you saying that. I think ultimately that's one of the reasons I got out of that business.
Oh, okay.
Because, you know, I was making a decent living and, you know, enjoyed the work for the most part, but there were guys that were doing a lot of unethical things, and they were really successful financially.
Oh, wow.
And I was, you know, making three times a good income, you know, and I'm looking around thinking that this is just not the right thing for me to be involved in. I have to sleep good at night, and I really want to help people. And when you're in that business, the people that are paying you are the companies, so mm-hmm. the companies that are hiring. So you basically work for that, you know, and at the detriment sometimes to the people that you're placing, you know, taking somebody out of a good job and giving them another position, and you know, it might be a good job that they're going to, and they should only leave for a good job, but you know, it just got to the point where they were really forcing the people in the staffing world to do kind of unethical things, or just, you know, got to make quota.
Wow.
You know, and that kind of led to me transitioning out of that business. That, and I looked around, and man, all the people that had been in staffing for a long time, a lot of them were chubby, bald, and really bitter. And I was two out of the three, and thought, you know, I'm not mad at the world yet. I think it's time to get out. So I ended up going to work for a web company, actually, and sold websites and help people market their businesses and talk to them about blogging and newsletter marketing and things like that, and really fell in love with that field, fell in love with the excitement of the new thing and launching sites for people. And then that was about a three or four-year job, and I walked in one day expecting them to single-thread all of the sales through me, and they told me it was my last day there.
Wow.
I had two great bosses. I still, to this day, were friends, and they were choked up a little bit when I walked in the room, and they said, you know, it's just economic things, and we just can't do anything about it right now. And I ended up leaving along with a designer that same day, and I got home early. You know, my wife's looking at me like, "What are you doing here? It's 10 o'clock." And I told her I wasn't working at that company anymore. But it was, and she's been a great supporter of mine for ever since we've been married. And she said, "You know, I really feel it's time to start that business that you've been talking about,
mm-hmm.
and you know, I feel like God's got a bigger plan here for you."
That's awesome, man.
And that's what started this entrepreneurial thing for the last 3 years that I've been working on. It was definitely a kind of a turning point for me.
Wow, that's interesting that you say that. You know, you got that's actually, you know, how it happened. And I think I found you on Facebook, and because you know, I always just assumed you were still, you know, finding people jobs. You know,
sure.
So I'm going to just backtrack just for the listeners. So you finished, and then you worked in the staffing, and then, like you said, you know, the guys were, you know, making the money, but, you know, it was just like in the moral fabric, you know. So what year did you go into your personal business now? Or when was the year that you were let go?
I was let go about 3 years ago.
Okay, okay.
From the web company, almost to the day. It's about 3 years.
Okay,
3 years and a couple weeks.
Okay, great. So it's wow. So you actually, for a while, 3 years time. I mean, it looks like you've been doing it for a while. Because when I saw it, you know, I just assumed you had been doing it for a long time. So could we give the listeners? Let's tell the listeners, like your company specifically and what you do and everything.
Sure. Currently, company's Transparent. I had a magazine online a while ago called Transparent Christian Magazine. It's just about living your faith every day instead of, you know, just on Sundays.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of the real, what does faith look like, you know, in a work conversation as opposed to just on Sunday mornings. So I just kind of adopted that word transparent into the business, and Transparent Social Media was the name of the company, and it's been dropped to Transparent. So that's the name of the organization. And what I focus on now is social media marketing projects for companies, coaching and teaching people how to use these tools to market their business. And really what it comes down to is I tend to find people that are great and lift them up. So I'm able to find an organization or somebody that's doing great things and then just help them get that message out to the world through social media.
Mm-hmm.
And I had, you know, I thought at the web company we were leaving some opportunities on the table with just launching a website, because it's really about what happens next. You know, that the site's up, product's there, or the service is there, but what are we doing about it? Mm-hmm. What are we talking about to our people? And social media allows us to do that.
Wow, that's really cool, man. So, and you're there, you're stationed there. You still live in Tennessee, right? Correct.
Right. Yep. Just north of Nashville, a little big town called Hendersonville.
Okay. Okay. Great. Great. And you're married, and I remember your son. You have two children. Is that correct?
Yeah, son and a daughter.
Okay. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, I remember I met your son. I remember he actually came in and he checked out. He was checking out some of my work I was doing one day.
That's right. He did.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
He's pretty technically minded now. It's funny you say that. I forgot that he met you.
Yeah. So how old is he now?
He's 13.
Oh wow.
My daughter's 15. Just started driving. So, you know, so it's crazy.
Well, that's cool, man. So a little bit more about Transparent, man. So,
sure.
So you have like a Christian base for what you're doing. So, you're developing people's companies. It doesn't matter. Like, let's say, like as for a hypothetical, like if the Marching Podcast would hire Transparent, would you like try to boost the hits or try to boost more?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. What we would do is we would kind of sit down and figure out what your goals are.
Mm-hmm.
And then we put a plan together, because what I've found is if we're just doing stuff, like I'm just going to make some Facebook posts, or I'm going to throw some tweets out, or I'm going to record some videos, and we don't really have a plan laid out, then the results are just, you know, sometimes they're okay, and sometimes they're good, and sometimes they're terrible. Like, there's no way to track what the message is.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say that I found out from you that, you know, the people that you're trying to reach are, let's just take entrepreneurs, and you want to reach entrepreneurs or, actually, you know what, isn't it, let's do this in real time. Who's your target audience? Yeah, tough question.
Yeah, I guess I want to say like middle school to, you know, graduates. So maybe anywhere from maybe 12 to 13 to 50, 60.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Okay. So we would look at what tools they're using. So maybe Facebook isn't their favorite thing,
mm-hmm.
But maybe they love Snapchat, and maybe they love Twitter, and maybe they love Instagram. And we would actually look at those platforms and create content and create a strategy to just have conversation, just talk to them where they're at.
Wow.
On that platform. And with the goal of something, if the goal is just exposure, then, you know, we're going to have the Marching Podcast logo on the bottom of some great pictures and push those out with a link to sign up for the podcast, or maybe we're selling shirts, or maybe we're going to be at an event. And everything we do is laid out in a fashion where for the months of, you know, June, July, and August, this is what our focus is going to be. And then we can measure those results, which is the other thing that we don't think about with social media is what kind of impact is it really having? Well, there's ways to measure that. You know, are we getting more signups? Are we selling more subscriptions? Did I sign up any new advertisers? So these are the goals, maybe the financial goals or the business-based goals that we have. And is this a good place to spend our money? Not every platform is the right platform for every organization.
Oh.
So, you know, you're posting stuff up on Facebook. If 16, 17-year-olds are sick of Facebook, you're not talking to them.
Right,
you're
right.
Your right audience, right? So it's that kind of thing. So, yeah, I'm helping with strategy and then how to use that and then how to track and measure to make sure that we're on point. And if that's working, fantastic. If it's not, then we need to readjust and move in another direction.
Well, that's cool, man. That's actually really, really exciting. Definitely something I definitely have to talk to you about more in the future, because, you know, that's what we're trying to do is just, you know, build more listeners and hopefully build
sure.
a scholarship fund so, you know, we can get more of those kids to colleges. So that's great, man. And hey, like I know that you are always doing, you're always helping someone. So that's why, you know, I wanted to highlight you today and, you know, give you props and give your company some time. So could you tell the listeners how we can support you and where we can get in contact with you? Or
yeah,
I know
sure.
anyone's small business looking for you out there.
Well, the best way to get a hold of me is on Twitter. That's I'm in the process of changing my website over. Right now it's wearetransparent.com. But you can get me on Twitter at Jason_Elkins, E-L-K-I-N-S, at Twitter. That's my Twitter handle. So it's at Jason_Elkins.
Okay.
And I would love to connect with people there. And I try to share and communicate tips, some advice, positive energy, positive motivation to others. There's a couple things that I've learned, and if anyone's interested in starting a business, you know, working hard is one thing. You already know that. You know, talking to a guy had three jobs when I met him, right? and you're doing several podcasts and working a full time job, and you got a family. I mean, you're a busy guy. So hard work, having a great support system, is important, and absolutely key is having some mentors. I have a business coach that I pay. It doesn't take a lot for me to run my business because it's a consulting business.
Mm-hmm.
He gets over half of my monthly budget just to make sure that everything's on track. I've got a spiritual development person that I pay to make sure that, like in my head, I'm going in the right direction as far as, you know, God's plan. He gives me tips and what to do
okay.
for that as well. And other entrepreneurs are kind of in my support system. So, you know, there are guys that we call and we check in, you know, where's your head at? How you doing this week? You know, what do you got? What can I pray for? What can I do to support you? Those things are really, really critical. And I'm just going to share one other thing that I'm working on. I've got a... when I started this business 3 years ago, I had one marketing strategy, and, you know, it started abruptly, right? So, like, I went to work one day, and then the next day I didn't have a job.
Mm-hmm.
And my entire marketing strategy consisted of this. I was going to have 100 cups of coffee in 100 days and just meet with people and see how I could help. That was the entire strategy. And I'll tell you,
wow.
I wasn't able even to make it through the 100 before I had projects and team
wow.
and support system. So this concept is actually turning into a book. So I'll connect with you and let's put that on the radar for maybe another podcast when that thing comes out.
Wow, man. Oh, well, yeah, definitely. All the people that I interview, I keep up with, and, you know, I'll probably be doing, like, second interviews just
sure.
to, like, update, you know, people on how they're doing. Definitely because, it's kind of like where the people are have touched my heart over the years, or, you know, people I've met ever since I started the podcast. But definitely, you know, I'll keep in contact with you regardless, you know. So, it'll definitely be exciting when that all launches, and, you know, I'll definitely put it on here. And, we'll go ahead and put that in the book for, like, you know, the platform, or like the book signing tour, you know what I mean?
There you go.
Yeah, man, that'll be great. So I got to wrap up the interview now, but I really appreciate your time, Jason. And like I said, I have you on Facebook, and what you're doing is great. And like I said, man, you know, I appreciate what you're doing. And like you said, those 100 cups of coffee, that's really powerful, because, you know, right here, you know, I was able to get my job and have my family and be able to be where I am, you know, because of people like you. You know, that was the number one thing was, you know, people say, oh, you went straight through undergrad and graduate school. That's great, but you haven't been working anywhere, you know, and I just needed that one little push. So I really appreciate it. And like I said, you know, that developing the relationship first before you kind of went out there, I think that was significant. And like you said, you could be making three times as more, but, you know, you felt like you had to get out and do what you're doing now. So that's why I wanted to highlight you today, and I really just appreciate all you do, man.
Man, I appreciate you, Joe. It's really humbling to hear that and kind of see the you know, fruits of labor actually really pay off in someone's life. I'm really blessed by that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, man. Well, no problem, man. Well, thank you, man, and we'll be wrapping it up. So thanks again, man. I'll be talking to you.
Thank you, Joe.
All right, you too.
All right, bye.
All right, we're back, and we back live, and we thanks to Jason for his time for the interview. I totally forgot about the paper route. That was another thing I did. So I had four jobs back then. You know, the time allotted me to do those. You know, like I wasn't 8 or 9 or 10 hours in one place, but I know like the paper route was like 2:30 in the morning, and, you know, I didn't work every day at the gas station and delivering pizzas, but, you know, and then I was on those off days, you know, I could try to sub where I could. But, you know, it was, I remember being tired, though. I do remember that, and I do remember, you know, I remember my car being worn out, too, because we only had one car. But it was great. It was great to meet Jason. Let me say it was great to meet Jason when I did, and it was great to catch up with him. And I was just thankful, you know, it could have been longer, but it was grateful that, you know, it was just my time, and I'll always be grateful to him for what he did. I'm glad that he owns his own business, and what a great idea with the 100 cups of coffee, you know, just to have that idea of, like, you know, I don't have work, but I'm going to go out and sit down and talk to other people, and that's just outstanding. So we want to make sure to let his, you know, let our listeners know about what he's doing, and we put his website and we put his Twitter there in the chat room, and I think I see Jason there in the chat room. So we definitely definitely remember all of those things. He actually left something. His paper route, pizza delivery, and actually gas station were all somewhat tied to navigation, which I thought was interesting since you were involved in mapping software. Okay, that's that actually is, and it's something I didn't even recognize. So shout out to Jason there in the chat room chilling, and shout out to the other people there who were there listening. But again, like I said, we're just grateful for his time, you know, and, like, you know, it's something that we definitely want to highlight here at the Marching Podcast Network is people helping people, you know, being that beacon of light. That's very, very important because we want to make the world a better place. So, you know, check out Jason's website, wearetransparent.com, and follow him on Twitter, Jason_Elkins, E-L-K-I-N-S, there on Twitter. And if you are interested in becoming a sponsor to a show or a patron to the Marching Podcast, you can contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial. We'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out your information through social media. We're proud to announce also that Blog Talk Radio has upgraded the site, so now we're able to add unlimited tags to our show. And also, we've opened up an account with Google AdWords, so when people search for those keywords or anything related to our show in any type of way, your business will start getting those hits too. So contact us so we can help build your business. Again, you're welcome to call in and talk before or after this last commercial break, before we sign off for the evening. I always like to play our beloved sponsors twice on the Choppin' It Up show. So we'll go ahead and hear from them. We've got a little time there on the clock. So if you're welcome to call in or welcome to join the chat room to leave any chats or tweet us or contact us in any way possible so we could get going. So, again, we'll hear from our sponsors one last time.
What's up, bandheads? This is Christy Walker, alum of the Blue and Gold Marching Machine of North Carolina A&T State University and one of the creators of thefifthquarter.com. And you are chopping it up on the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, you're about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556. Do you know where to find scholarship information and other financial resources that are available to HBCU students? Are you up to date on the latest information in the HBCU world? If you answer no to any of these questions, then HBCU News with the Reads is the place for you. We provide information to spark interest, success stories of graduates, and the latest on issues that you care about. So check out HBCU News with the Reads, Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern on blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Check out our website and point your browser toward hbcunews.net and join in on the calls and discussion today. Block Band is a minority-owned music business that you can think of as your assistant band director. We help grow your musicians with a great selection of traditional concert band music. Then we back up their performance with necessities like reeds, oil, drumheads, drumsticks, and mallets. Finally, we outfit your players in auxiliary and shoes, spats, and gloves that match our precise custom drills. Got band? If so, then Block Band's got you. Check blockbandmusic.com or call us at 919-698-2560. That's blockbandmusic.com, 919-698-2560. What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. And coming this fall, HBCUBands.com. Write that down, HBCUBands.com. Choppin' It Up with the Marching Podcast is a podcast of one-on-one interviews with positive role models that have a connection through music and or education. We also give the listener an opportunity to call in and talk with our guests. Choppin' It Up is all about inspiring our youth for a great future and providing a roadmap on how to get there. We also chop it up to give insight to anyone looking for information, inspiration, and advice in their endeavors. Chop it up with us every second Tuesday of the month at 8 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Chopping it up, changing the world through positive interaction. Are you ready for this year's College Battle of the Bands? Well, look no further than the 90 Degree Show brought to you by the Marching Podcast. Every Sunday during the college football season at 8 p.m. Eastern, we recap the most intriguing battles of the weekend and give you, the listener, an opportunity to voice your opinion on the battle by calling into the show and talking with our panelists. Check us out on Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. The 90 Degree Show, the world's first and only interactive HBCU band podcast show.
Hello, this is Dr. David A. Paget, director of the Geographic Information Sciences Lab at Tennessee State University, and you're chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we are back, and we're back live. And, again, we love our beloved sponsors. Last couple of shows are some other programming that we have here on the Marching Podcast. We have the 90 Degree Show on Sundays at 8 p.m., and we chop it up just like we're chopping it up now. We also have the HBCUnews.net. Jeff and Sharon Reed, their wonderful magazine blog, and they come on, we alternate Tuesdays, but they come on the Tuesdays here on the Monster Podcast Network as well. So I don't see any calls, and we have a couple people there in the chat room, so I've left a couple of chats, so we'll probably close out the show. But again, we wanted to just say again thanks to Jason for, you know, his help and his diligence for what he was doing. Even though, you know, he was fulfilling his job, he definitely was helping me out, and it's really cool to hear him say that, you know, he was really, really excited to see the fruits of his labor, or just see, like, how things turned out for us. I remember a couple times I was frustrated about a couple things there, just working in the environment, and I just remember we were able to keep a good relationship during that time. He asked me later on in the chat room how long I was there at Smart Data Strategies before I went to ESRI. I was there about a year and 2 months. I remember I started, I started like in October 2004, and then January 2006 I started. And I remember the Katrina situation had something to play in my actual interview. So, man, I'm starting to remember things as the more we talk. But I'll go ahead and close out the show. I really appreciate all those listening. Check us out at themarchingpodcast.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Thanks for listening. And remember, advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. See you next time.